an extremely crucial time when the world and our country is going through very, very trying times. Sadly, sir, 2020 was a complete washout, and therefore the people of this country look at this budget with great hope and aspirations. So after the several life lessons that COVID taught us, at the same time, we have witnessed on the one side that nature was blooming because man was imprisoned in his own home. And on the other side, in spite of being in our own home, we saw that there were several climate events which happened in our country, like the super cyclone Amphal, which had a speed of 260 kilometers per hour, which actually razed Odisha, your state, sir, and West Bengal. And then Nisarga on the western coast, 118, which again affected Maharashtra, Mumbai most, where we had the maximum COVID cases in the country, sir. Here the observation made by Yuval Noah Harari, the historian and philosopher and author of famous books, sir. I would like to quote him because I feel it is very relevant what he has said. He said during the lockdown that the storm will pass, but the choices we make now could change our lives for the years to come. I think as far as India is concerned, this budget is the first ever document after the COVID which really sets a roadmap as to how our country needs to go ahead and what are the choices that we are going to make. Sir, climate change poses one of the biggest challenges of mankind. It challenges our very, very existence. Our future is at stake. Countries all over the world are declaring climate emergencies. Sir, India is one of the hot spots and vulnerable to climate change. And sadly, sir, I feel sad that there is no mention of this impending danger in the budget speech or the book that we have got. In the short time, sir, that I have been allocated, I wish to focus my interventions on the issue of environment and climate change and wish to flag four observations which go to expose our missing sensitivity to the impending issue and shows that our choices are blatantly out of place. On the one side, where environment is failing us or we are failing the environment, it is an irony, one, that we have reduced the budget allocation for the Ministry of Environment, Forests and Climate Change. So the total budgetary allocation for the ministry is ₹2,869.93 crores this year, as against ₹3,100 crores last year. So there is a drastic reduction of 230 crores. Extremely disappointing, sir. Second, the point which I want to make is about air pollution. We know and keep reading that our cities, the Indian cities, are becoming gas chambers. According to the Lancet Planetary Health Report released in December 2020, air pollution claimed 1.7 million lives in India in 2018. Another report, Global Burden of Disease report in 2017, it says that air pollution kills one child every 3 minutes in India. In this budget, sir, government has allocated ₹2,217 crores to tackle pollution in 42 cities. Last year, it had accounted for ₹4,400 crores for clean air. We don't know how that amount was utilized. And even if it was utilized, it is sad to see that amongst the worst polluted countries over the world, 20 cities, 15 cities are housed in India. According to the Greenpeace India's annual report 2020, 231 out of 287 major cities which were studied had PM10 levels exceeding the 60 unit level prescribed by the CPCB under the National Ambient Quality Standards. So we have, sir, 231 cities which are already killing people, and here we only try to address 42 cities, which again is a matter of great concern. Third, sir, the loss of GDP. According to the Lancet Planetary Health Report, India has lost 1.4% of the GDP due to premature deaths and morbidity from air pollution. So to understand this better, because 1.4% of GDP, one doesn't understand how much it means in monetary terms. So in monetary terms, this is equivalent to 2,60,000 crores in monetary terms. And to understand it still better, it means more than four times of the allocation for healthcare in the last year's budget. So this is something again which is a matter of great concern. If we have to see the loss percentage of GDP in the states, UP tops it by 2.2% loss and Bihar 2% loss of GDP. My fourth point, sir, the economic loss due to climate change. According to the Global Climate Risk Index 2020, India suffered an economic loss of $37 billion due to climate change in 2018 alone. Apart from several climate disasters in various parts of our country, the glaring ones were the worst ever in 100 years floods in Kerala, which claimed 324 lives, damaged 20,000 houses, 80 dams. There was a migration of 2,20,000 people. They were forced to migrate out of their habitats. Losses due to these amounted to $2.8 billion. In the same year, sir, India also experienced heat waves with temperatures above 50 degrees centigrade in various parts of our country. Chennai, sir. Sir, I have some 6 minutes. Eight minutes, I was told.
7 minutes.
So how many minutes do I have, sir, to finish?
Only 1 minute left.
So please, let me, yes. Chennai, sir, which has a million population, ran out of water and had to be transported from outside. The message is loud and clear, sir. We know that all these are results of reckless damage to the environment. We have been alarmed time and again by experts and scientists, but sadly, we do not pay heed. And worse still, we continue to carry destruction unabated even today. And to cite a few projects, sir, the Char Dham Pariyojana in Uttarakhand site, where a massive 900-kilometer road is being made in the Himalayan ecological sensitive region with blatant violations of the law, the declassification of salt pans to wetlands. We are diluting the EIA norms, the NGT norms, the CRZ norms, the National Forest Policy. The dense forests in the country, especially Chhattisgarh, are being opened up for coal mines. Government is hoping to denotify the Kachua Wildlife Sanctuary and several other sanctuaries. Sir, my last point only, I urge the government to ponder, to introspect, to analyze, and decide what is the path that we need to take. And this is something that is absolutely important. I will end my speech, sir, by quoting a para from the book Hot, Flat and Crowded, authored by Thomas Friedman. And he says, imagine a world without forests. Imagine a world without corals. Imagine a world without fish. Imagine a world where rivers flow only in the rainy season. Not only is that possible in more and more places, it is possible in our lifetime. So, sir, I urge the ministry and the ministers, let us wake up. Let us bring the issue of climate change at center stage. Only then the state governments, local governments, and the private sector and individuals will really wake up to this need. There is no time to lose. We have to act now.
Thank you.
For the future of our generations. Thank you, sir.